sharing yet. Just I'll allow for a couple of minutes. It is 9:06. I will be starting or my screen sharing in around 2 to 3 minutes. Now, so to come to the point, ladies and gentlemen, an incisional hernia or a ventral hernia and the management of an incisional hernia or the ventral hernia has undergone a very lot of changes that have happened probably in the last 10 years. Now, what is more important is that there has been a lot of operations that have been discussed. And what is more important is that we have now more or less understood the implications about something called posterior repair, or what is the placement of the mesh is something that we have tried to understand, and we have tried to make an more or less a flow thing or a flow diagram, as you can say, about how do people understand about what is exactly an incisional hernia and how does an incisional hernia story start with. Okay, all right. So now, ladies and gentlemen, if you just give me a minute, it is 9:06. Now, what are the important things to understand in various processes, about what are the various processes, what are the various defects, and what are the various algorithms that we follow, or what are the things that you should talk about in ventral hernia surgery? Just allow me a minute. It is 9:05. I'm waiting for other people to join in. I think all of more or less have joined in. So we start with ventral hernia. It would have been really nice if someone had presented a case. And it would have been really nice if people had participated in the discussion. Okay, let me have the screen sharing to begin with. So what is the Zoom thing? Yes. Start. Now, whenever we talk about incisional hernias, ladies and gentlemen, remember that the first and the very basic thing to understand is what about, or in a simple technical word, what are the important points to be taken in history. Now, when you talk about the term incisional hernia, in the European Hernia Society classification, all ventral hernias technically have been renamed under this single heading of an incisional hernia. So before we talk about the EHS classification, in an examination style that goes by, what is important is that examiners are required to tell you or ask you a few questions that concern about the history in the patient. So when you talk about the history, or is the screen visible to everyone? Hello? Right. When we talk about the history in the patient, what becomes very important is what is the surgery that the patient had at the initiation or the initial surgery. And what I usually start when I write or present a case of an incisional hernia is, I start or present a case beginning from the incision that the patient landed up with, or incision number one, and then I proceed on to what are the events that happened. If there is an incision number two, say for example a lady had a cesarean thrice, then what are the events that happened after this, and thereafter now maybe there is a hernia, or maybe there is a direct linkage of an hernia with the incision number one. So this is the first and the important point to note about is in surgery, what are the initial hernia, or what are the initial incisions that happened, or what are the events that followed in the immediate postoperative period to talk about or to make our ideas very clear about what is going on. Now, when I talk about, yeah.
ventral hernia and incisional hernia both are similar.
Right. So we are going to come to that, sir. And remember that I will be talking about that. That is incisional hernia equal to ventral hernia? We are going to talk about that very, very quickly. Now, because as I've said, this is also one of the questions that are asked in a by-way examination, and examiners have their own style of answers to talk about. Now, coming back to the event, sir. So, for all practical purposes, if you ask me, my opinion or personal opinion is start with the initial incision and then proceed to the hernia. You can either start with that the patient noticed a bulge in the upper part of an abdominal incision for the last 6 months. The incision was that of an old emergency abdominal surgery for which the patient, or an emergency surgery that was done 10 years back. Since 10 years, the patient did not have any complaint except for the last 6 months, when he or she complained of a lump in the upper part of the skull. And then the lump increased in size, was initially painful. The pain has remained same till the last 6 months. The lump was initially about 2 by 2 centimeter in size, has now progressed to get around 15 centimeter in size. It was initially reducible and now it is difficult to get reduced. Reduction is accompanied by a gurgling sound, or when the patient has a strain like a cough, the lump increases in size. So, ladies and gentlemen, I told you a story that always starts with a lump, and I told you about the characteristics of the lump that are important with a hernia. Hernia, because I told you about the pain that the patient is facing, and after we have talked about the pain, I have also told about reducibility, and beyond reducibility, I have also told you that it increased in size on standing or on coughing, and again it got reduced. I told you about the content being bowel, and I have finished my history of present illness in this point. Now, this is what a group of examiners like to have, because they feel that the scar that was done 10 years ago and the hernia that has now occurred are two different sets of disease. Now, I really beg to differ from those who have said like that. And what I usually go for is a very straightforward point. If you are going by this technique that I have told you, the past history then should detailed about the operation that was done and what was the post-operative event. So this is one way of thinking, and some people say that this is an older way of thinking. I personally do not like this way. I begin from the emergency surgery, and from the emergency surgery that was done 10 years ago, I track down to what happened in the post-operative events. And after the post-operative events are done, what was the convalescence of the patient? And after we have talked about the convalescence of the patient, then the next part of this is, what was the straining factor that the patient developed in the last 10 years? Maybe smoking, maybe obesity, maybe lifting heavy weight. That is not considered to be a straining factor, but still difficulty in micturation, ultimately to be followed by the development of the hernia. So this is what I feel is a much scientific way, because the scar in an incisional hernia never does change that great. So, well, you can go by technique one or technique two. That is something that you like. Depends upon how do you gauge or understand the scarring that happens and an incisional hernia that happens in that. So what is important is, so this is the first point that you have to understand. The reason about talking in this style is, this is the first confusion that 90% of examiners and 99% of students do have. So please be very clear in the style that you are going to present. Either way, I feel the style number 2 is more scientific. If you feel no, style number 1 is something that suits me, please, definitely you can go by, nothing is wrong. So this is what is the first and the most important part of the history. And then you are required to talk about the examination findings. And when you talk about the examination findings, apart from the general survey, the only thing that I am interested in the general survey is beyond the vitals, is the body mass index of the patient, which is extremely important because obese people having a hernia are going to have a recurrence about 15 times more than that of a non-obese. So the BMI is important to know whether you will at all operate on a hernia or not, which is a big, big, big important question. There are many hospitals which tell the patients to reduce the weight and then come back after 3 months so that they can plan an operation. But again, so in a real world, things may not be that way. But still, in an exam, you should offer to the examiner that I will request the patient to decrease the weight before the operation. Now, when you talk about on abdomen examination, now remember that abdomen examination is exactly that by any other abdomen examination, except that you have to add a point called as the parietal, you can add anterior abdominal wall. There will be posterior lateral abdominal wall too. And here you are required to describe the scar, the length of the scar, the length of the hernia, the width of the hernia, the domain of the hernia, or which area of the abdomen in relation with the umbilicus, the xiphoid, and the symphysis pubis does the hernia happen. If you are asking why am I being meticulous like this, because very quickly we are going to read something called as the EHS classification of a ventral hernia, which is now the standard of care to be described in an operative chart discussion or in a postgraduate forum. So length of hernia, width, the domain, etc. And then after that, talk about what is the gap in the rectus. Then talk about what is the tone of the rectus. After that, when you have discussed the tone of the rectus, it is good enough to talk about something called as a malignant bulge, which indicates a swelling by the lateral side of the rectus and also suggests that there is a weakness in the innervation of the rectus. Beyond this, you are also required to comment upon, after you have done so many things, you are also required to comment that this swelling has a cuff impulse, if it at all has that, and is this swelling reducible or is it irreducible? Some people add the cuff impulse and the reducible story to begin it and then followed by this. Okay? Hello, am I audible, everyone? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Right. So this is all about what are the things to describe. So let us have a quick recap. What are the things that I will describe? I will start with the lump having cuff impulse and reducibility. Then I will come to the length of the scar. Then I will come to the length of the hernia. Then I will come to the width of the hernia, which area of the abdomen wall, that means in relation with the xiphoid, the symphysis, and the umbilicus. What is the gap in the rectus, which is equal to the gap in the hernia usually? What is the tone of the rectus? And finally, by the lateral side of the rectus, do I get to see any malignant bulge? Okay. Have you written about this, sir?
Yes, sir.
Done, na? good, because examiners are wanting this to be said by you guys. Now, if they are okay, so what is important is that if there are more than one hernias defects with a normal intervening area, say for example a patient has this kind of a defect where this and this kind of hernias happen, so you are required to combine the full length, that means 1, 2, and 3, and then you are required to tell the examiner that yes, there are midline hernias occupying the length from this to this, which are multiple in number, is something that you are required to comment. Some people call this as a Swiss cheese hernia, which is half the truth, because when you talk about a Swiss cheese hernia, I hope you know why is it called as a Swiss cheese, because the Swiss cheese, if you cut the Swiss cheese, say the box or the block, well, unlike that of a cheese that we have a concept on, like that in a pizza, we have a concept that the cheese flows or cheese burst flavors. The cheese is usually a solid block with multiple small holes. A Swiss cheese hernia will mean an anterior abdominal wall hernia seen on laparoscopy or laparotomy with multiple hole defects that are in vicinity. So there is not one small hole or large hole. There are 15 holes maybe in a similar area. But on a clinical examination, it simply appears as a bulge. So that type of hernias are more prone to recurrence than this. So this is the first point that you have to understand. To know about all of these, examiner will ask you, what is the intervention or the clinical method that you are going to elicit on this patient? Can you tell me? What is the clinical method to elicit these findings? Hello? Come on, ladies and gentlemen. Sir, the test is simple. I will tell the patient to have the legs raised up. Particularly important if the hernia is a lower abdominal. If it is an upper abdominal hernia, can you tell me what is the intervention that you are going to do?
Shoulder.
Sir, the intervention is? The intervention is?
Head
something
head
called as a head rising test. But what is the technique of doing the head rising test is sometimes asked, and in a real world examination, it is to be shown to the examiner. How do you do the head rising test? Leg rising, I can understand. It is an SLR. Slit leg rising test. How do you do the head rising test? I just need one word from you guys or one sentence maximum. The patient should not support himself or herself on the elbows. You can try that today also. After the class, just lie down supine and try to now raise the head without a support from the elbows. You will see that humanly you will try to support your elbows and then rise. If you do not use your elbows, can you tell me which is the muscle that you are making taut?
Rectus abdominis.
Very good. The rectus abdominis, or technically called as, remember, the strap muscles of the abdomen. This is a new terminology that majority of hernia surgeons across the world prefer, because AWR is now a subspecialty, and there are hernia surgeons in the year of around 1990s to maybe 2015. After 2015, a group of hernia surgeons have now called themselves as AWR surgeons. Okay, so this is a new specialty that has come up. So this completes the clinical tests that you are required to do. How to measure the gap?
Sir, why to do this test?
Pardon, please?
For what use we are using this? For malignant bulging or for prominence of the
hernia? Sir, this is the reason I told you. why should you be doing the test? The test is done because the length of the scar and length of hernias are very easily appreciated. I am doing this test to see whether I'm doing this test, what is the gap in the rectus, which is measured by you, not only using your scale, but using your hand, and then keeping your hand in the defect. Now, what is important is, see exactly the site of the defect, provided it is a reducible hernia, that what is the defect size in relation with, because if the patient is raising the head, what is important is that you cannot keep your hand inside the defect, or if the rectus muscles, or the next thing that you are testing is, you are requiring to test what is the tone of the rectus muscles when the patient is raising the head. If the rectus muscles are coming medially, they are pressing on your hand, and you are not being allowed to put your hand into the abdomen, that means that the tone of the rectus muscles is okay, and that, believe me, is a very healthy sign. That means if you go on with placement of a preperitoneal mesh, a retrorectus mesh placement, then that is important and can be done easily. However, if on doing this test, the rectus muscles are going wide apart and you can now easily enter into the abdomen technically and feel even maybe the aortic pulsation in L1 and thin, that is not at all a good sign. And remember, that will suggest that there is an atrophy of the rectus. And whatever technique you are going to do, retrorectus, whatever intraperitoneal mesh placement, you are going to have a tough time with the recurrence, because this is not a very easy job.
Divarication of recti.
Very good. And now coming to the problem about something called as the word that has come up very recently, called as divarication of recti. Now, what is the story about a divarication of a recti? Now, the story about divarication means, the word divarication technically means separated. Okay. So, like divorce, divaricated. Now, divarication of rectus has been congenital, has been acquired. But there is a big problem with divarication in that. The difference between a hernia and a divarication is, in a divaricated rectus, remember, the rectus muscles are going to get separated widely. But at the end of the day, appreciate that there is no bulging that is going to occur. And the linea alba more or the less tries to remain intact. That means the patient, whatever he or she does, there is no sac that is seen. Whereas if you compare a divarication with a incisional hernia, the basic difference then will be the gap in the sheet. And through the gap, you will have a peritoneal sac with the content that comes out. Divarication may not require a surgical intervention except for a cosmetic purpose. Divarication will not lead to a strangulation. Incisional hernias will obviously lead to complications, starting from irreducibility to strangulations. I hope, have I made the point clear, sir?
Thank you, sir.
Good. So if you have understood what is a divarication, and if you have understood what is going on with divarication, then the next point to understand in this small story is only one. After you have seen about all these clinical findings,
so it is all of surgery in divarication.
Indication of surgery, sir, is cosmesis. And those who do a surgery for divarication, particularly it has come up in the last 5 years with advent of laparoscopic big procedures, their stories are, or their say, the intent that they say is that we wanted to prevent a future hernia, which is probably an exaggeration of a fact. If you are doing an hernia, or if you are doing a surgery and a divarication with the saying that you will prevent a hernia, well, then you are tailoring the patient to the operation. You are not tailoring the operation to the patient, which is not at all a very principled thing to do. and I do not technically do an operation for a divarication of rectus. You may have discussions in various forum that I did an operation on a divarication of rectus, I did this, I did that. The answer is, if you did not do the operation, what would have occurred? The answer is nothing. Until and unless the patient had a straining factor, it will not lead to a development of an hernia. So please remember that. So whenever you talk about the incisional hernias, the next part of the story then to talk about is, you are required to test for, look for abdominal lump. You are required to test for, look for straining factor. And by straining factor, you know what is a straining factor. Cough, constipation, micturition in women, pregnancy. And then after these are done, it is always a good point to have an examination of the lumbar spine. Particularly large hernias produce a lumbar lordosis and a neurogenic pain sometimes. And after you have done, always look into other hernias. That means inguinal hernia, femoral hernia, lumbar hernias, okay, spigelian hernias, to remember. This completes your examination. Definitely look for liver, spleen, ascites, that is done. Look for straining factor by doing a DRE, auscultating the chest, palpating the bladder. Always look for the lumbar spine and the changes in the lumbar spine. And finally, look for other hernias as well. So this is what is the clinical examination of a patient of an incisional hernia. I think
so. Why the spine examination?
Why the spine examination? Very good. Because we are going to now, because I think that a major part of the class today has been taught by Dr. Rudrajit Sinha in your pathophysiological changes or physiological changes in incisional hernias or joint incisional hernias, the lecture that he gave. So what is important is, we are going to come to that very quickly. Now, after you have done that, the examiner will ask you, what is your diagnosis? Now, the diagnosis of this is like an inguinal hernia. It is good to say my patient is a 48-year-old lady, incisional hernia, through what scar? Lower midline scar. Sorry for my bad handwriting. Content is bowel. Reducible. Uncomplicated. Now line stops. Right, good muscle tone. And lastly, right, no straining factor. Please complete writing, then I will proceed, sir. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Have you completed writing, sir?
Yes, sir.
Good. So this is how we complete the diagnosis of an incisional hernia. Now, quick discussions, and definitely I do not intend to stretch it beyond exactly a clinical case discussion. Examiner will say, anything more that you wanted to comment? Anything more that you wanted to comment? The answer for your question is, if you wanted to comment anything more, sir, I wanted to comment upon the European Hernia Society classification of a hernia. What type of hernia? Sir, we are talking about a incisional hernias, and we are talking about this classification system, which is different from other ventral hernias. So that means we'll talk about definitions, and then Now, what is important is that European Hernia Society classifications divide all anterior abdominal wall hernias. Remember, all anterior abdominal wall hernias into two groups. Now, this will come to be your answer. Either they are called as primary hernia or they are called as a incisional hernia. Combined, if they are known to occur in the midline, they are called as a ventral hernia. Have I made you understand this point? What is the difference between a ventral hernia and an incisional hernia? A incisional hernia and a primary hernia in the midline together, according to the EHS, are called as a ventral hernia. Have you noted this down, sir?
Yes, yes.
And then, or either it could be a primary hernia or it could be an incisional hernia that is not in the midline, but it is lateral. Now, they are definitely not called as a ventral hernia. They are called as lateral abdominal wall hernias. Have you completed writing, sir? Hello? Done, na?
Yes, sir.
Good. If you have completed writing, then let us understand by making a picture. So, the picture of concern is that when you talk about a midline hernia, what is midline hernias or ventral hernias, so as to say ventral? Draw the patient's abdomen, and after you have drawn the patient's abdomen, umbilicus, this is the rectus sheath. Anything that happens within the two borders of the rectus sheath will be called as a midline or a ventral hernia. Anything that occurs within the two borders of the rectus sheath are called as a ventral hernia. This is what is a ventral hernia, which is equal to either a primary hernia or an incisional hernia. Now, when I talk about a primary hernia, can you name me some primary hernias of the anterior abdominal wall in this midline? Yes, sir. There are two: epigastric hernia and umbilical hernia, which are called as primary hernias of the anterior abdominal wall. Whereas when you have an incisional hernias can be definitely, as you can understand, can be any part of the abdomen, any length of the abdomen, which is an incisional hernia. But what is very important is the EHS consensus. What they have made is, they have tried to unite epigastric, umbilical, etc. Because they are very right in doing so, because the management is more or less the same. And they have tried to say that we really give a thought about whether it is midline or incisional. And then after our thought, we understood that it is immaterial whether it is epigastric, umbilical or incisional. Let us talk about which part of the anterior abdominal wall it is. If it is umbilicus, make a point 3 centimeters above and 3 centimeters below the umbilicus. 3 above, 3 up, 3 below. If you consider this area, 3 up, 3 below, this area or hernias in this area, 3 centimeters up and 3 centimeters down, are called as umbilical hernias or umbilical region, or according to the EHS terminologies, are M3 hernias, midline 3 hernias, 3 up, 3 below. Whereas, if you think over with the xiphoid, and then anything that is within 3 centimeters of the xiphoid are technically called as sub-xiphoid hernia or M1. Have I made you understand what is M1 or sub-xiphoid? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Good, no? Clear about the concept? Okay. Then if this is M1, then what is M2? M2 then is a distance that is 3 centimeter below the xiphoid, but 3 centimeter above the level of umbilicus. Have I made you understand, or should I use a color to make you understand, which will be a much better word, sir? This one is technically then called as M2. So what will be the name of M2?
Supraumbilical.
No, sir. It's better called epigastric. So by this time, if I now ask you to define an epigastric hernia, usual MBBS answer is hernia that occurs in the epigastrium is epigastric hernia. Now, as a postgraduate, can you tell me how do you define an epigastric hernia?
It can be defined as, sir, the hernia 3 centimeter below the subxiphoid area and 3 centimeter above the umbilical area.
Very good. And will you like to refine your answer, sir? Everything is there on your screen. This is exactly. So now, can you combine both these terms and now again define an epigastric hernia for me? So epigastric hernias are those midline hernias which are 3 centimeters below the xiphoid, but 3 centimeters above the supraumbilical line or above the level of umbilicus. And according to the HS classification, are M2 hernias. Okay? Have I made you understand this point, sir?
Sir.
Yeah. Should I repeat? Hello?
No, sir.
No? Good. Thank you, sir. If that is M3,
sir,
let us mark out the symphysis pubis and mark out a distance of 3 centimeters above the level of symphysis pubis. This kind of hernias are technically midline hernias, are called suprapubic hernias, and anything in the gap between suprapubic and less than 3 centimeter are called as infraumbilical hernias, which are M4. So what is M1? What is exactly M1 subxiphoid? What is M2 epigastric? M3 umbilical, M4 infraumbilical, M5 suprapubic. Have you written the definition, sir? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Oh, good. If you have completed right, because the European Hernia Society classification also gives an importance to not only the length. What is the other thing that I told you, sir? Not only the length. I am interested to know about the size of the hernia, or I am interested to know about the breadth of the width of the hernia. So this is something that I am interested to know. Now, when I talk about the width of the hernia, the width of the hernia is defined by the HS as less than 4 centimeter. W1, 4 to 10 centimeter W2, and greater than 10 centimeter W3. So that means, now tell me, a manual laborer has a ventral hernia which measures 5 centimeter. Can you tell me the EHS of this hernia?
M2W2.
This is M2W2. Very good. Now, can you tell me the diagnosis clinical of this hernia?
Epigastric hernia.
Very good. Can I complete the word, sir? Beyond only the single word epigastric, then what will be the important things to talk about beyond the diagnosis of epigastric? 45-year-old gentleman, epigastric hernia containing bowel, maybe containing preperitoneal fat, omentum, maybe reducible, uncomplicated, good muscle tone, no straining factor. Please remember, this is important to comment. So is this comment about what is the EHS classification? And beyond the M2W2, will you like to add any other word, please? Will you like to add any other word? Yes, sir. I will like to add, it is a primary hernia, because in the world of incisional hernias, M1, M2, M3, M4, M5 are more or the less, they have been defined for incisional hernias. But again, if you read the EHS statement or document very clearly, these are for midline hernias. But yes, we have extrapolated from incisional to epigastric and umbilical also. So this is all that is required. If you are asked about why do we need the size of the hernia, what is one single line answer for that?
To plan the management, sir, like because certain hernias which are small in size can be repaired primarily and set.
Excellent.
Placement of
that means, very rightly said, you are trying to suggest that anatomical repair can be done for hernias with small size. We are coming to that very quickly. What is my operation selection that we have? Then after this is done, so this is what is important about midline or ventral hernias is equal to epigastric and umbilical. Now anything that goes lateral to the midline, remember, anything that is lateral to the midline will be given a nomenclature of L. L is lateral. Now the L is divided into four zones. Remember that. Now, the L is divided into four zones, meaning that L from the lateral border of the rectus, you are required to mark another line till the anterior axillary line. And now, you are required to divide this again very simply by a statement that if this is the umbilicus, mark a band which will be approximately 3 centimeters above the umbilicus and 3 centimeters below the level of umbilicus. So 3 above, 3 below. And now the story becomes easier. Between the rib cage and the hernia, this one, this kind of incisional hernias, or technically enough, lateral hernias are called as L1. Okay, or this is called as L1. Whereas, if you have, say, this one, this is called as an L2, and anything inferior to this is called as an L3. Okay? So this is how the thing goes by. And if there is any hernia that is beyond the anterior axillary line, the best example of this is an inferior lumbar hernia, will be an L4. So what is an L4? How do you define an L4? L4 is anything beyond what line?
Anterior axillary line.
Now, sir, can you give me, if these are lateral hernias, can you give me an example of a primary lateral hernia? Incisional hernias in L1, L2, L3, you can. Like subcostal incision will produce an L1 incision. Can you give me an example of what operation will produce an L2 incisional hernia? In your practice as a general surgeon, pretty common in vascular ward.
Lumbar, thoracic abdominal approach.
Can you give me an example of an L3 incisional hernia surgery? Come on, guys, simple. Appendectomy. Very good. Okay. Can you give me an example of an L4 hernia incisional?
Nephrectomy.
Yes. Nephrectomy. Very good. Or nephrectomy incisions, excellent doing. Okay. Now, if that is incisional, let us talk about lateral primary hernias. That means God gave the hernia. Can you give me an example of a hernia that occurs in L1, L2, L3 on the lateral border of the rectus abdominis? Excellent. So that hernia that occurs as a primary hernia in L1, L2, L3. Now, technically not L3, between L1 partly, L2 partly, is called as Pygelian hernia. Excellent doing. So that means in a clinical perspective, where will you find a Pygelian hernia? To be defined as a Pygelian hernia, now by the HS criteria, where will you get the Pygelian hernia, sir? One word. Where will you get the Pygelian hernia? One single word. Where will you get the Pygelian hernia? There it is, on lateral border of the rectus abdominis. Very good. This is what I wanted to hear. And can you give me an example of a primary, non-incisional, lateral hernia in L4?
Lumbar hernia, sir.
Lumbar hernia. Very good. Which triangle? Superior or inferior lumbar triangle?
Greenfield inferior.
Both. The answer should be both. Definitely, inferior lumbar triangles are usually acquired. They are usually after bone marrow biopsies or bone chips. But superior lumbar hernias are always, or more or the less, not always should be a wrong word, around half of them are spontaneous, half of them are incisional. So, if you have understood the concept about the EHS, if you have understood how the modern terminology and the modern day examiners use this term, I think I will be happy. Have I made you understand these new terminologies that have come up? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Good. Thank you. Because this is what I wanted to stress upon. Because the management of incisional hernias, the minute you talk about management, all of you have your own thoughts. And all of people have their own thoughts about what should be the management and what should be and what should not be done. So after these things are done, then we talk about what is the, after these things are done then, give me a minute. We talk about what should be the management that is done and what is the treatment that is done for these patients. Now,
excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please.
Common clinician.
I could not understand.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please go on, sir.
Sir, if I have, for the nomenclature, I have a multiple defect between the two big hernia, suppose umbilical and supravivic. So I'm labeling as a M3 kind of W1 and M5 as a M5, suppose W3, sir. But there are multiple defects in between. So how to name that one, sir?
That is exactly what I really liked. Now, sir, what I am going to do is that you have rightly exactly pointed at the same question that I had. Good question, sir. Now, the multiple defect studies are usually seen. Say, for example, you have a midline. Now, by the midline, you know what is midline now. Lateral border of the rectus. There is one hernia, by the way, this is the umbilicus. And this is the xiphoid. This is the symphysis. One hernia is here. Another hernia is here, and another hernia is here. This is what you wanted to say, sir?
Yes, sir. These are the three primary I can name easily. But if between...
No. Come on, man. I'm asking you one single answer. So what will you call this to be? This will be hernia number A is equal to M2W1. Hernia number B is equal to M3W2. Hernia number C is equal to M4 W1. Are you going to name it like this? This is the reason EHS came together, said that, boss, don't get confused. Very simply, talk about what is the uppermost extent of the hernia. At this side, what is the uppermost extent, sir? M2. And what is the lowermost extent of the hernia? M4. So you are going to describe that I have a ventral or an incisional hernia, M2 to M4. And along with that, I have a width of hernia, which will be from this to this, maybe W2. Have I made a, you understand this part?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The reason about talking M2 and M4 is, on a therapeutic point, why should I be required to know M2 to M4? Or there is someone with a... Exactly. Because what is important is, if I have to buy a mesh, or if the hospital has to buy a mesh, the question is how big the mesh. This is a problem that all of you have faced every day. How big a mesh do you need? The answer is, if you go by a 5 cm overlap or beyond the edges, then you know by this time what is M2 to M4 by a W2, and this is what you are required to remember. Okay?
Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Please, sir, is the word paramedical hernia still existent? Because according to this, sir, classification, we didn't
exactly
speak about it.
Very, 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 very good question. Really, it is really nice talking to you, ladies and gentlemen. Really, believe me, and I really like this forum, because it basically is a forum that I really find sensible people here I can talk to. Very good question. EHS, the last consensus, does not mention the word paraumbilical. He only, now this is what I am talking about, is couple of years back, but that is what is. It is a 2009, 10 years old consensus. EHS did not talk anything called paraumbilical hernia. You know what is an umbilical hernia? That's it. But believe me, the examiners that may ask you what is an umbilical and what is the paraumbilical hernia. Is the word paraumbilical hernia obsolete? Well, technically, according to the EHS, yes, it is obsolete. But in an DNB or an MS examination system, please don't say it is obsolete. What is an umbilical hernia, sir? Thank you for raising the point. What is an umbilical hernia?
2 centimeters around the umbilicus, sir.
Sir,
the 2 centimeter radius.
You are so motivated by the EHS, I really appreciate that. According to the conventional gyan that we have, an umbilical hernia, according to our old knowledge, please see the neck of the sac. What is the thing that you have learned from the neck of the sac in this patient? In an umbilical hernia, who forms the neck of the sac? Come on, I made the picture for you. The neck of the sac is made by what structure, sir, in an umbilical hernia? The neck of the sac is made only by the umbilical ring, only by the umbilical ring, nothing else. Whereas in a paraumbilical hernia, the neck of the sac is made partly by the umbilical ring and partly by the anterior abdominal wall. Which one occurs in an adult? Paraumbilical or umbilical?
Paraumbilical. Umbilical also.
Very good. And paraumbilical is known to occur only in adults. Which type of adult, sir?
Middle-aged.
Pregnant woman.
Obese. Paraumbilical is mainly a problem of obesity. Umbilical hernias are known to occur in children. Remember, we wait for something called as the age of 3 years. There is something called as the rule of 3 in an umbilical hernia in the child. Okay. And we wait for maximum 3 years. 3% of the population of term children are born with this. The gap is 3 centimeters in size, and we wait till 3 years. It can also occur in adults. Can you tell me an adult with an umbilical hernia? Hello.
Ascites.
Very good. So these are the points, sir. Okay. So have I removed the doubt about umbilical and para-umbilical? Thank you for raising this question. I just forgot this area. Thank you for bringing it up. Okay. Any more questions, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, there is an association between hypothyroidism and umbilical hernia.
Sir, those are theoretical things. Please. That is cretinism, hypothyroidism. Sir, let the medicine guys and pediatrics think over it. We are surgeons. Let us now think about what to cut and what to do. Okay? Now, let us talk about...
It should be based on CT scan finding or clinical findings.
Good question. I really liked your question, sir. It is nice that you guys are thinking. Sir, it is like the TNM of a cancer. It is both clinical as well as CT scan. Why? Because majority of something called as loss of domain hernias, they are technically irreducible. And if they're irreducible, how do you know that it is M2 to M5 if you do not know the size of the gap? So it is both a clinical and a CT scan. It is both. Okay? Chalo. Okay. This is all that is done.
Sir?
Yeah?
So is there any relation between pregnancy and umbilical hernia or para-umbilical hernia repairs?
Pregnancy and para-umbilical hernia repair. I could not understand that question. Now.
Sir, today a patient came into our OP, sir. The patient had umbilical hernia, sir. We were told to ask the patient if she plans any future pregnancies. How does that correlate with umbilical hernia repair, sir?
The answer to your question is easy. Umbilical hernia, the eversion of umbilicus, are technically two things that look the same. They are not. Eversion of umbilicus does not have a defect. The umbilical cicatrix is stretched and produces an eversion of the umbilicus. When the pregnancy is terminated, that means after the delivery is complete, the umbilicus within 1 to 2 months returns back to the normal state. Now, after the pregnancy, which is a precipitating factor, the umbilical cicatrix may develop a defect that is an umbilical hernia. Should you repair an umbilical hernia in an adult? Yes, an umbilical hernia in an adult is repaired as it is painful and as there are chances of a bowel strangulation, which are much more higher than an inguinal hernia. Now, what to do if the patient comes with a pregnancy, painful, irreducible hernia, that then has to be considered as a strangulation and you have to repair it on an emergency basis. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Have I made you understand this? Chaloji. Done.
Sir, in ascites patients, we will operate, sir.
Sir, umbilical hernia, right, umbilical hernia in ascites, when to operate? Sir, umbilical hernia in ascites, Saviston more or less gives 2 or 3 criteria. Number one, when there is a skin necrosis. Number two, when there is a leakage. Number three, when there is a bowel strangulation or omental strangulation. Okay, all right. Chalo.
But sir, we always operate on hernia to prevent complications.
Yes. Technically, yes, sir. In a ventral hernia, we try to operate because there are complications, except as I told you, the rule of three. Okay. The rule of three, technically, 3% of the patients, a population is born with a hernia or an umbilical hernia. 3% probably will need at all a surgery for a hernia or an umbilical hernia. Okay, right. So what is important in this word is, after you have done into that, then how should we treat a patient with an incisional or an umbilical or an ventral hernia? I will now try to taper my talk, because the more we discuss, the more things will always go on, because this is such a big topic. This probably does not have any end. Okay, we can talk hours on that. Right. Now, what is important is, the first thing is, you need to make the patient or discuss the need for operation with the patient. This is what I will do. I will discuss the need for operation with the patient. Number two, I will require to do some pre-operative investigations. Out of this, the most important investigation always is a CT scan of the abdomen, and not an alternative, please, and a ultrasound of the gallbladder and the uterus. In males, definitely the prostate. You know the reasons why. Now, why do a CT scan? Now, this is something that I really have tough time explaining to my residents also. And the problem is not my residents, the problem is my colleagues who do not understand till why should I do a CT scan in an incisional hernia. Point number one is, I need to define something called as loss of domain. The definition for the loss of domain comes by a criteria that is called as Tanaka index, okay, or another criteria called as Sabag's criteria or Sabag's index. This is the point number one. Point number two, I need to see the status of the rectus muscles. I need to see the vascularity of the rectus muscle. I need to see the flat muscles, whether there is any atrophy in the flat muscle. Number four, I need to see the gap size. Number fifth, after that, I need to see any other abdominal pathology that can really produce my problem. So these are a very simple general surgeon's take on what are the things that you saw on a CT scan very quickly in a patient with an incisional hernia. So please remember that. Hello?
Contrast CT?
Oh, CT scan, sir, is always CCT, oral IV.
So MRI will be not better?
No. Till the studies that have been done, everyone has used a CT criteria, sir. MRI probably is a much more, I do not know, because the 2020 Delphi consensus that I'm going to show you, they have based all their consensus on use of CT scans. See, probably the reason people have done a CT scan, maybe the reason is that we surgeons are more easy understanding a CT scan than an MRI of abdomen. Believe me, even I am 10 times more happy when I get to see a CT scan, and I hope the same thing with you guys also. So it is good to read a CT scan. I can read a CT scan within 1 minute. I can take 10 minutes to read an MRI. So this is the reason I take a CT scan to be read. Okay. So this is what is seen on all patients about incisional hernia. If you are asking me, is it mandatory to be done? In the present world, yes, sir, it is mandatory to be done. If you are talking about an incisional hernia, ventral hernia like umbilical, spigelian, etc., it is good to be done, which tells you about the size of the defect. And sometimes even you can see the content. If the content is bowel, what is the vascularity of the bowel? Please tell me when you have completed writing. Okay? Hello.
Done, sir.
After you have done writing, then we need to prepare the patient for an operation. And in the preparation of the patient for an operation, few points stand up very clearly. First of all, a theory question comes. What are the pathophysiological changes that are required to happen in a patient with an incisional oblique ventral hernia? Well, the main pathophysiologic changes that happen includes that as the bowel loops get out into the new space or the new cavity, what happens is that these bowel loops, there are portal vein branches which get compressed. The compression of the portal vein branches produces bowel edema. And bowel edema produces, again, more difficulty or irreducibility, sometimes may be responsible for producing diarrhea. But what is more important is that it promotes more bowel edema. And this process goes on. What happens when you forcibly result in, what happens when you forcibly, by the way, before I say forcibly, I should make you understand one thing. The more is the enlargement of the sac. Now the sac is something called as a second abdomen. What happens is that this is the second abdomen. This is the bowel loops that are there in the second abdomen. Appreciate that how much less bowel loops are there in the initial abdomen. Now, where is the center of gravity of the body shifting? Come on. This man is showing you. See this abdomen. Where is the center of gravity of the body shifting? Anteriorly. So what will happen to the curvature of the spine?
Kyphosis.
Okay. Sir, this will be an extreme. Initially, remember that the curvature of the spine was, what is the curvature of the spine? This is the curvature of the spine. Now, what happens is that to compensate for this, rather than this change happening, the paraspinal muscles act together. And when the paraspinal muscles act together in this region, the spinal curvature initially becomes straight. And then the more we pull, the spinal curvature will go like this. Because the big abdomen is now pulling the back. Now the only problem is that it leads to a very severe low back pain. And the patient usually spends his or her time in the bed, lying down rather than walking around with the sac. Now what happens when these bowel loops are returned in an operation? Very simple, you know this. When bowel loops are returned in the operation, either the diaphragm is tented, is pushed up. When the diaphragm is pushed up, there is a VQ mismatch. And the VQ mismatch is responsible for producing hypoxia. Whereas, when the preload is known to decrease, the cardiac output decreases, the renal perfusion decreases, urine output falls, which is not a very happy finding.
Why preload is decreasing?
Sir, because the inferior vena cava is compressed.
Got it.
This full disease is called as an eventuation disease. So the big problem is, how will you make this patient ready for an operation? part of the ventilation disease is characterized or treated by staged pneumoperitoneum. That means you put a catheter in the peritoneal cavity and every alternate day or once in 7 days, you take around 5 to 6 liters of carbon dioxide, inflate the peritoneal cavity, gradually increase the volume of carbon dioxide. But again, we are not going to discuss this, as I've told you. This is such a huge topic. We can talk around 3 hours on this and the story does not end. Okay, but in exam, you are required to know about this part only, and hence. Now, how to prepare this patient? So the first part of preparation of this patient is chest physiotherapy by use of spirometer, steam inhalation, etc. The basic idea is that the more you make the lungs work, the better it is. The next of this thing to remember are, this patient should lose weight if this patient is obese. The skin and the wound and the skin and the hernial sac, particularly the bigger hernial sac that you get to see, what do you think will be the problem in this part of the hernial sac?
Intertrigo.
Intertrigo, sir, is a good word. Fungal infections. But again, remember in ulcer chapter you read, if the patient is hanging that abdomen for 23 of the 24 hours, this is going to develop something called as a decubitus ulcer. And believe me, if you have seen obese patients, 150 kilos, with that huge thing that is hanging down, it is really the smell that comes out with this decubitus ulcer, believe me, it is horrendous. So this is technically the part that you are required to know, and you are required to prepare the patient by talking about other cardiovascular parameters, but the most important one will always be a chest physiotherapy. Majority of anesthesiologists will always go for something called as a flow volume curve to assess the lung function. Apart from the FEV1, the FVCs, etc., they will like to do a flow volume curve to state about the lung function in this patient. So this is what you are required to know in this point of the story, to talk about what is the preoperative preparation. Finally, what is the operation that you are going to tell? Finally, what is the operation that you are going to tell? Now, sir, things are difficult to answer sometimes in an examination, because the reason is that, because as times have evolved, believe me, ladies and gentlemen, I really find it very difficult to teach about incisional hernias for one single reason. There are a few things which are very standard, like the operation should always be about something called as a mesh hernioplasty. Now, that is something that is we have known, that we have to give a mesh for this procedure called as a incisional hernia. Now, the question is not giving the mesh, because you have proved beyond doubt that you need a prosthetic device to repair the hernia. The questions are two: where to place the mesh, which route will you take to place the mesh, and the third one, which is less important, what mesh will you use? Now, definitely, I will request you to attend. Dr. Sinha has taken a beautiful class on the various surgeries for the ventral hernia. I will just give you a quick summary about what are the various the principles of repair of these kind of incisional hernias. So we'll talk about the placements of the mesh and what is the important things that you are required to know about the hernias. Just give me a minute. Okay, just give me a minute. Let me have a gulp of water. Right. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good. So just take a glass of water, please. Now, where to put the mesh and what to do? Okay. Now, I think Saviston gives an excellent picture, which I feel should be repeated by everyone during his or her exams, not only exams, in practical life, to understand where to put the mesh. Or what is the terminologies in putting the mesh? Because this is asked in an exam, and this should be known to you very clearly. If remember that this is the rectus muscles, and as you know, the gap is between them. These are the three strap muscles, the external oblique, the internal oblique, and the transversus. Okay. And what is the hernial sac then? Let me take a minute. Quickly, let us make the hernial sac. This is the hernial sac. I have lined with the peritoneum with a blue color. So what we do is that in this kind of a repair, please understand what I'm doing one by one. So what we are trying to do is that we are trying to put the mesh in the gap only. So we are trying to bridge the gap. Oh, sorry, I should take another color. We are not being able to understand. Yes, I think this color is good. Yes. If I give the mesh like this, just attach it to the margins and the peritoneum is down. This is called as an inlay mesh placement. Okay. Now we are not coming to what is good, what is not good. The next kind of a picture is, this is the sheath, the rectus muscles. And out of the rectus muscles, then again, as I have said, the peritoneum is bulging like this. What we can do is that we can make the hernia go in and the peritoneal layer is down here. Let us take the mesh here. And when you have the mesh with you, the mesh is placed covering the part of the rectus muscles also. So please see that the mesh is covering the part of the rectus also. This is called as overlay. That means the sac is placed inside overlay. And what is good in this technique is that the bowel contents are not coming in touch with this one. But we are not talking the advantage, disadvantage. But the biggest problem is you are in front of the rectus abdominis. Now, these are not very good operations, with the logic being by the Pascal's law, the pressure is more inside. So if you have not understood what is the operation that should be good, the best way to make you understand is that there is a bucket of water. And when you have a bucket of water, this bucket develops a leak, or there is a hole in the bucket. Where will you like to put the plug? Outside the bucket or inside the bucket? What is your opinion?
Inside.
Why inside, sir?
More support will be there and less giveaway will be there.
Simple words. Good one. That means within an inguinal hernia surgery, appreciate that overlay is that patch that is outside the bucket. That is under tremendous pressure. Whereas inlay is more or the less an okay operation where you are inside the bucket. But the problem is that patch or that plug is very small, sir. You are exactly on the size of the hole, which is not a very intelligent idea to do. Now, the next part of this is, so let us see what we should be doing then. So if these are the three muscles, okay, then this is the peritoneum. So what will he do now? Sir, what I will do now is that I will try to place this bucket-like thing, the patch-like thing. And what I will do is that I will place this in the peritoneal cavity. Did you see where did I place the mesh? The mesh is in the peritoneal cavity, or better called as intraperitoneal, also called as underlay. So you have learned three terms today: inlay, overlay, underlay. Three terms today. Now, can we make it little more advanced, because this is in touch with the bowel loops, and as you know, we're not very happy because you cannot use a proline mesh. You need meshes like EPT, FE, etc., which do not react that great with bowel. So can we have something better? Yes, we can. Definitely we can. We have the rectus muscles. We have the three muscles. And after we have the three muscles, then let us make the peritoneum in this picture. So what we'll do is that the peritoneum is a sac-like structure. What I'm going to do is that I'm going to take the peritoneal sac, dissect the peritoneal sac, and please see what I'm doing. And what I have done is that I have made the peritoneal sac and the peritoneal sac margin stitched. What I have also done is that I've taken the mesh, and after I've taken the mesh, I have placed the mesh in this plane. What will you call this plane to be, sir?
Extraperitoneal underlay.
Good one.
Pre-peritoneal.
Very good. Now see, again, sublay is a very difficult term again to make you understand, because underlay and sublay more or less will be the same meaning. This is technically a retrorectus, if you understand by this term. And if you have said, this is technically enough, retrorectus, and what is important is this is pre, some people call it as pro, which are both the same terms, peritoneal. Pre-peritoneal, pro-peritoneal. Okay? There is a variation of this technique where what you can do is that if this is the muscle, this is the muscle fibers, or sorry, the three external oblique, etc. And this is the hernial gap. What we can do is that we can repair the hernia. Okay. And after, guys, we have repaired the hernia, then let us take the mesh. And after we have taken the mesh in the preperitoneal plane, what I intend to do is that I need to make the mesh hinged up. And this is called as sublay. You may say sublay is something that is between the muscles and the peritoneum, but it is technically intermuscular. Okay. So this tackles this part as sublay intermuscular placement of the mesh. So that means if this is the terminology to do, which mesh usually, if you are not using in the peritoneal cavity, you can use a polypropylene mesh. If you are using in the intraperitoneal cavity, it is good to use a bilayer mesh, which means one side is polypropylene, that means the parietal side. The visceral side is a non-adhesive layer. It can be various things, like even a collagen sheet, etc. Some people have used biological meshes, some people have used PTFE, but it is good to use a bilayer mesh. Now the last question, and we will end the day with this one, is what route are you going to do this? What route will you take to give the mesh? Now, you may agree with me, you may not agree with me, but in my practice, I am not an AWR surgeon. I have colleagues in the city who are excellent AWR surgeons, and they have their publications with more or less an idea about what to do. Their algorithm is that if the hernial defect is more than 2 cm, the hernia is a primary hernia. I think by this time you know what is a primary hernia. Hello.
Yes, sir.
And it is minimally symptomatic. I will not say asymptomatic. It is minimally symptomatic. This goes in for a anatomical repair, commonly also called as a suture repair. You can try for an IPOM. I think you know what is IPOM. Intraperitoneal only mesh.
Only mesh. Only mesh.
Okay. Which can be done, but I think it is more of an overkill. I will go for this rather than this. Okay. Less than 2 centimeter recurrent hernia or an incisional hernia, more or less, which are the same terms for that. Either you can do an open or a laparoscopic procedure, and the procedure, if doing lap, is better as an IPOM. Okay. Now, if it is 2 to 4 centimeter gap, incisional, by this time we are meaning from this point all as incisional, either you do it as an open or a lap. Remember that it is now called as an IPOM plus. Okay. Now, if it is an IPOM plus, okay, done. If it is more than 4 centimeter, okay, then it is good to think about in open to go for a technique called Reeves Stopa, usually bilateral. In laparoscopic world, you go for something called as ETEP. I hope you know what is TEP, total extraperitoneal placement of mesh, and E means it is extended upwards to do the procedure. The principle remains the same. If the gap is between, remember, more than 4 centimeter, and I should write 4 to 8 centimeter, very sorry on that one. If it is, remember, 8 centimeter or more, okay, it is good to do something called as ETEP TAR. What is TAR? Transversalis abdominis release, not repair, release, and can be done laparoscopically. E mane endoscopic and extended cis. Now, what is more important is, if it is more than 12 centimeter, preferably, if it is more than 12 centimeter, you go for an open TAR. And if it is 12 centimeter plus redundant skin plus sinus tract infected mesh, then it is better to go for an open abdominal what is that thing called as an open ACST, component separation release, okay, either anterior or posterior. Okay, this is an area where only mesh may be useful. So, sir, I have tried to give you, or I have tried to make an algorithm type thing. This is more or less with this new bust of the procedure that have come up over the time. This is how people have modified themselves into what is what on this procedure. Okay. Have I made you understand this part, sir?
Yes, sir.
So, what is ACST, PCST? Sir, component separation. Anterior component, posterior component separation.
Sir, what do you mean by only in this case, sir?
Only in this case will be, sir, exactly with this simple principle. Only or technically will be the overlay.
Okay.
Sir, can you explain IPOM and IPOM plus ones?
IPOM
the diagram.
See, sir, IPOM means so when the diagram is easy. Just give me a minute. What did this thing happen? Color pencil, कहाँ है? हाँ. So this is the blue alert. Now this is the hernial sac. In an IPOM, what you only do is that you need not take up the mesh. This is the advantage of a laparoscopic repair. You take in this one, and then you just put the mesh in this gap. Do nothing. Just put some tacks. The mesh is fixed. This is technically called IPOM. That means in an open or in a two dimension, if this is the gap, and IPOM technically will mean that you put the mesh down here. The mesh, as you see, is covering the gap. And when the mesh is covering the gap, you put in some tacks, and this is technically an IPOM. What is an IPOM plus? Now, sir, the gap size is more.
Hello?
People say, yes, sir.
In IPOM, why we use the term only? Basically, you see.
Only, like it is intraperitoneally placed. So, how can it be only?
That is the difficult. Now, see, the main problem is these are the terms which are very confusing. If you ask me, it should technically be an inlay mesh because you are placing the mesh in this placement. You are only covering maximum little bit of gap on this side. Okay. So this is, sir, intraperitoneal only placement of mesh because the only term should usually be in an overlay term like this. But again, that is really the paradox of this term about what is this only placement of the mesh. In an IPOM plus, the main point is what we do is that we go on suturing this area with interrupted transfascial sutures, try to decrease the gap size, and then we go for placement of the mesh. Okay, so this is what I know, sir. I usually do not do a lot of lap hernias, but still, these are the principles that I usually follow in this. Now, TAR is something that we have started doing. It's a very tedious operation to do. Okay. And ventral hernia sometimes is a really very challenging one. Right.
Sir, okay, so I think that between TAR and ACS.
TAR and ACS, sir. Now, or the you are technically asking me the difference between TAR and PCST, probably. TAR is ACSTs or CSTs are where you cut the various abdominal wall layers and try to repair the midline, whereas the lateral defects are cured by the layered cuts so that the hernia does not happen in that place. So technically enough, more or the less, a PCST or a posterior component separation and a TAR goes by the same principle. In a TAR, you have to only divide the transversalis abdominis. The PCSTs, you have to divide not only the transversalis, maybe even some fibers of the internal oblique also, if they are producing tension.
Sir,
epigastric hernia,
true hernia or not?
Epigastric hernia, I could not understand. Epigastric hernias?
Is it a true hernia?
As you have very rightly pointed, the main content of an epigastric hernia is a preperitoneal fat. Hence, it is not called as a true hernia. It is called as a pseudo hernia.
Thank you. Sir, what is Reeves-Stoper repair?
Sir, Reeves-Stoper repair is, I think, okay, sir, I will request one special class only on surgical techniques of ventral hernia. I think Dr. Sinha has taken a class on the laparoscopic repairs and the open repairs of that. Now to complete, sir, what is a Reeves-Stoper technique? Reeves-Stoper technique is that you make a midline incision and do not open the peritoneal sac. You go around 5 centimeters above the level of umbilicus, at least for an infra-umbilical hernia. You dissect 2 cm medial to the anterior superior iliac spine, and your placement of the mesh goes up to block the femoral ring and the upper point. So this is the ribs and the stopa. Or giant prosthetic reinforcement of the visceral sac. Okay, there are other techniques like
outline, sir. For the recurrent or incisional 2 to 4 cm, in the open procedure, it's a mesh or primary repair, sir?
So it is always a mesh. Anything more than this is always a mesh.
Anything more than 2 is always mesh.
Right.
Okay.
Then the suprapubic hernia correspond to M5,
sir? Suprapubic hernias will technically be M5. Because M4 ends 3 cm, M5 is 3 cm above the level of symphysis pubis. That is M5.
Can you explain loss of domain once?
Loss of domain. Okay, so this story then will go on. It is already 1 hour 40 minutes. Okay, sir. Very good that you raised this point, because I was really forgetting to talk about this. Now, what is loss of domain? Now, this is an interesting quantity that you have raised. Good that you raised this question. Sir, loss of domain technically means that I can understand or make you understand, because across the world, believe me, people have tried to define a loss of domain, which they have failed. Honestly, there are consensus definitions which have been only one consensus. What is loss of domain? Now, loss of domain has been identified that when majority of the intestine or the viscera are in a second abdominal space and replacement in the abdominal cavity produces physiological changes. Now, this is, remember, the understanding of loss of domain. If you see the published literature, there are various confusions about, till to this date, we did not have any united consensus. As of the year 2020, people have started making a consensus, what is called as loss of domain. There has been an objective criteria. There are more than around 8 definitions of loss of domain. Out of the objective criteria, I think I'll be showing you a picture. Just give me a minute. Just give me a minute to share my screen. Right. Now, this is what I intended to show you. Thank you for making me remember to show you the loss of domain. Now, this publication is dated 2020, as you can see this one. This definition, this consensus came because people thought about that we should know what is loss of domain. We go on asking our students, and then let us ask ourselves, what is this one? Now, to talk about, there are many things written. Of interest in this is to know, there are 2 methods to know about. Something called, hello, right. So, what is important in this is, now, see that there are 2 methods to talk. Of these methods to talk, there is a technique that is called as Sabag's method, in which he tells that loss of domain is more than 20%. Another method is called as Tanaka's method, where they have calculated what is the percentage of the loss that is out. So there are 2 methods, the Tanaka's method and the Sabag's method. Loss of domain is 20%, both of them are done. Now, these things are calculated based on a CT scan finding. Mind you, these are done based on a CT scan finding. Please understand that. Okay. Which is easier to do? The Sabag's method is easier to do and understand. The Tanaka is more popular. So, the loss of domain is defined according to volumetric criteria. There are CT scan measurements or software which are usually done to make people understand this. Okay. Chalo then.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So thank you, everyone. We don't have any.
The recording has stopped.
What I will do is that I will request Dr. Bakshi and Dr. Sinha to take his class exclusively dedicated to operations, particularly the endoscopic operations of ventral hernia. Okay. Sure. Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Thank you, sir.
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 Thank you, sir. Doing the screen share. Very good evening, everyone. Hello.
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Right. Good evening, sir. Good evening, everyone. Like as we do for the last of the couple of OSCEs, I always show you the questions, take 5 minutes in writing the questions, and then we'll proceed to this part. Today I have done, apart from images, there are two videos also, because I thought that we'll be graduating ourselves, and with this computer-based examinations, videos should be the norm of examination. I think we should start now. Ready, everyone? Can I start now?
Yes, sir.